Am I audible? Thanks, Arika. The first poll question is to just check whether you understood what was discussed in the last lecture. The plan of lecture today is to discuss separating and throttling calorimeter quickly, because the videos have already been uploaded, and then I would be starting with the vapor power cycles. What is the answer, Sarika, about the poll question? Tell me your answer. What separating and throttling calorimeter does, whether it measures the calorific value of steam or it gives you the dryness fraction of steam. You can type your answers. Ananta. Okay, Ananta is written. Sarika, what you have written? Akanksha Saunke. Type your answers. Apeksha Patil. Okay, Jay, you are right. Apeksha Patil. Aditya, okay, you're right. All right, Rushali. Gargi, yes. Gunjan. Sarika. Kaif Sheikh. Yash More. All right. See, what I see is that about 40% of the students are saying that it is used for determination of calorific value of steam. So I just wanted to know of the students who have responded, who has, because 50% of the class has given this option, that means around 22 students have said that it is useful for determination of calorific value of steam. So I just wanted to know who are those students. So please, if you have written this option one, Just write down your names so that we can discuss this further. Pathan, Rajan, Selva, Selva, Rajin, Saurav Jadhav. Okay, so let me close this poll question and let me start with the discussion. I'll just be closing this poll in a minute. Okay, I'm not very happy with the responses. As I see, around 70 students have joined. Okay, in spite of the fact that it is 11:20, and yeah, Akanksha, you are right. Ganesh, you are right. Sharvari, Yash. These are usual names which I see almost always. That is a worrying part because that shows that we would have a very poor results in the final examination. Okay, you know that your exams are scheduled in January somewhere. Okay, and if you are lagging in self-study, it is difficult for you to score good marks, especially in conceptual subjects like thermodynamics, okay, fluid mechanics. So let me just quickly go to the whiteboard, which I have. Let me see that first. Okay, so I'm closing the poll now and I will be showing you the results. Okay, as you see that of the students who have voted, 56% of the students have correctly answered this poll. Okay, the answer is obviously the option B. Separating and throttling calorimeter is used to determine the dynamic fraction of steam. Okay, so this I'm closing now and let us go back to the discussion. So just tell me whether the whiteboard is visible. I'm shifting the board now. Okay, yeah, so the whiteboard is in front of you and yeah, thank you Jay Gargi. As you see, I had shown you the diagram of the setup which you have in our lab. Okay, so this is a setup which talks about separating and throttling calorimeter. Now to explain you what is separating and throttling calorimeter, I had already given you a lot of schematics, so. And I had also discussed the observation table. Okay, so let me just revise it quickly. The separating and throttling calorimeter, as the name indicates, is used for determination of dryness fraction of the steam. And what is dryness fraction of the steam? Dryness fraction of the steam is nothing but it is a ratio of the dry portion upon the given steam. Okay. So you know that steam, any steam would have certain water fraction in it, liquid water fraction in it, and the remaining would be the dry part, mg or ms. Okay. So the gas part is there and there is a water part. Okay, I'll use mg instead of ms. Yes, just mg. Okay, so mg is the dry fraction. And the mg plus mw is the total fraction of the steam, total steam. Okay, so which would include the moisture, that is called as dryness fraction. Now as you had seen in the videos, there are actually three calorimeters. One is the separating calorimeter, other is a throttling calorimeter, and third is the separating and throttling calorimeter. Okay, so today I plan to discuss why we are using a separating and throttling calorimeter instead of only a separating calorimeter or only a throttling calorimeter. It means that I would be discussing the drawbacks of using a separating calorimeter for determination of dryness fraction of steam or a throttling calorimeter for determination of dryness fraction of steam, and why the choice is for a separating and throttling combination. Okay, so what is a separating calorimeter? So a separating calorimeter, as the name indicates, is a physical separation of the steam. Okay, so what you achieve is, suppose this is a chamber, okay, it's called a separator, and you take some steam from the steam pipe, the steam main, whose dryness fraction is to be measured. Okay, what you do is that, as I told you, that there are buffers in this, and this would physically separate some liquid water in it. Okay, so suppose this is m weight, okay, wet steam. So some water would be separated, and this steam would be relatively dry. Okay, and the dryness fraction is, obviously ms upon m weight, okay, or it is ms upon mw plus ms. Okay, now the drawback of this is that this is very simple construction. What you have to do is that you will have to take the wet steam whose dryness fraction is to be okay, this you will how you measure this ms, again you'll have to send it to the condenser, and condenser becomes condensate, and you collect it in a beaker, okay, calibrated beaker, so from which you will get the volume vs, again read the specific volume, and from which you calculate the mass. Okay, so this separating calorimeter is pretty simple. Because it has only a separator which physically separates the liquid water, right? And you can readily measure the volumes, that is the volume which is separated, volume of the water which is separated, then read the specific volume from the steam table and get the mass of water. Similarly, the steam which is let out of the separator, this is a separator, this steam is condensed by passing some cooling water. This condensate becomes liquid. So this is the now liquid because it is condensed. This was earlier gas. Okay, and this condensate because of is the mass balance. So gas mass and volume, liquid mass is the same. Volume is different, but mass is the same. Okay, so that you collect it in the volume, in a beaker, calibrated beaker, and that specific volume or density you note down, and you get the mass. Okay, so in a way you are taking two readings, okay, one is of ms and one is of mw. Okay, and that ratio, is a dryness fraction. So this is how you calculate the dryness fraction using a separating calorimeter. The problem with this calorimeter is that we cannot physically remove the entire amount of water, this water fraction. So this, suppose there is 10 gram of water which is to be removed, okay, right? But this separator would remove only 8. Okay, are you getting the point? This separator would remove only 8. It means that the dryness fraction which we will be calculating using a separating calorimeter would be inaccurate. Okay, we can get roughly some value of dryness fraction, but because it is impossible to physically separate the moisture, okay, from the separator completely, so that becomes a drawback of a separating calorimeter. Okay, the second calorimeter is a throttling calorimeter. So throttling calorimeter means you have a throttling device. Throttling device, you know that it is a narrow constriction, which would allow the pressure drop. Okay, So the steam whose dryness fraction is to be measured is passed through a throttling calorimeter. Now, what is a throttling calorimeter? Throttling calorimeter means it would have an arrangement for measuring the pressure, okay, and temperature before throttling, and it would have an arrangement for measuring the pressure and temperature after throttling. What arrangements you will have? You will have a thermocouple and you will have a pressure gauge. Okay, so a throttling calorimeter is a very simple device where you will have we'll have to note the pressure before throttling and temperature before throttling. Then you'll have to measure the pressure after throttling and temperature after throttling. Okay, so this four readings would be required for throttling calorimeter. And then what is done, what happens is that, now let me plot it on a enthalpy entropy diagram, right? So before throttling, if you get, okay, so this would be wet steam, and after throttling it would be a superheated steam. Okay, so if it is before throttling, now I have drawn an enthalpy entropy diagram. Okay, now throttling, you know, is an isenthalpic process. Isenthalpic meaning the enthalpy remains constant. Okay, so throttling is an isenthalpic process. It means that the enthalpy before throttling will be equal to enthalpy after throttling. And this you see that on the enthalpy entropy diagram, this would be a horizontal line. Now, what is this? This is a vapor dome. Okay, so within the vapor dome, the steam is wet. Within the vapor dome, the steam is wet, and outside the vapor dome, the steam is superheated. Okay, right. Now, if you know the pressure or temperature before throttling, right, the enthalpy of the wet steam, you know that it is HF plus X times of HFG. X times of HFG. And how will you find this? This by knowing the either the pressure before throttling or by knowing the temperature after throttling. Okay. So from the steam tables, one can find the value of HF and HFG by either knowing the pressure before throttling or by knowing the temperature before throttling. So only one parameter is required. Either you take pressure reading or you take the temperature reading. Okay, before throttling, I mean to say. Now after throttling, what you'll have to do is that you need to, because the steam becomes superheated, so you need to find H superheated. Okay, we are not taken problems of finding the superheated steam enthalpy, but we will do that later, right? So for knowing the enthalpy of the superheated steam, what we'll have to know is that we'll have to know the pressure after throttling, and we'll have to know plus we'll have to know the temperature after throttling. So if you know the pressure and temperature of the steam, then one can find the enthalpy of the superheated steam. Okay, as I said, we are not yet taken numericals on how to find the enthalpy of the superheated steam, but now just remember that from the steam table, one can find the enthalpy of the superheated steam by knowing the pressure of the superheated steam and the temperature of the superheated steam. Okay, so once you get this, then the unknown is dryness fraction, and this way you get the dryness fraction of the steam by using the throttling calorimeter. Okay, now what is the drawback of this? Is the drawback is this: suppose the steam is much weight. Okay, if the steam is very weight, then what happens is that suppose this is a vapor dome and the steam is considerably weight, and if you throttle it, then sometimes, okay, if you throttle it after throttling, the steam remains weight, it does not become superheated. Okay, why is that so? You look at the diagram and it will be clear to you. Okay, suppose this is the pressure line, this is the pressure before throttling, and this is the pressure after throttling. So pressure before throttling is P1 and pressure after throttling is P2. And suppose that expansion, P2 obviously is less than P1. So that is, this is the expansion. 1 to 2 is an expansion process. Okay, this is also 1 to 2. 1 to 2 is expansion process. That is the pressure reduces, right? Now, if the pressure reduces such that the steam does not end up in the superheated region. And why is that so? That would happen if the steam is considerably weight, right? Then what happens is, if you write the equation here, so you'll have this equation as HF plus XHFG at state 1, because it's the wet steam, is equal to HF plus XHFG at the state 2. Meaning what? The meaning is you'll have two unknowns. Okay, and getting two unknown, okay, from a single equation is mathematically impossible. So that is a drawback of throttling calorimeter. What is the drawback of throttling calorimeter? The throttling calorimeter drawback is that if the steam is sufficiently weight, then after throttling, the steam does not become superheated. And if the steam does not become superheated, there is no way of finding the Dynes fraction, because you will get an equation with two unknowns, a single equation with two unknowns. Whether this is understood? If this is understood, say yes. Okay, Sharbari is saying is understood. Pranav is saying is understood. Okay, Darshan is saying he has understood. Akanksha has understood. Anamta has understood. Okay, thank you. So, all right. Thank you, Nikhil, Neha, Ganesh, all of you. So now that becomes a drawback of a throttling calorimeter. And in order to overcome this drawback, what you have is a combination, okay, a combo. What combo you have? You have a separating device. Its name is separating and throttling calorimeter. So you have a separating part, okay, and you have a throttling part, okay. So this is a separating part where you physically separate some liquid water. You separate some liquid water here, okay, and then you throttle it. Okay, then you throttle it and then you condense it. Okay, then you send it to the condenser. I'm drawing a line diagram. The actual diagram I had shown you. I'll show you again that diagram, but line diagram I'm drawing for just understanding sake. So what you do is here, you physically separate the water, right? And then you throttle it and then you throttle it. Okay, so before throttling, again, as I told you, you need to know the pressure before throttling. Okay. Or temperature before throttling, and after throttling, you need to know both the pressure as well as temperature after throttling. Okay, and then you condense it and collect it in a beaker. So this beaker volume you know, okay, and this beaker you can read the specific volume from the steam table. Similarly, this water which is separated, you collect the volume VW and read the specific volume VW from the steam table, right? So this would help us calculate MS, okay, and this would help us calculate MW. Okay, so this way, by using a combination of separator and a throttling device, what happens is, let me show you on the enthalpy entropy diagram. This is a vapor dome, okay. The steam, let us say this is the dryness fraction of the steam, means it is that much weight. So what you do is that, you suppose this is one, state one, and this is state two, and this is state three. Okay, so one to two, what you do is that you first, suppose this is your initial state, right? So one to two is this. So this is at a constant pressure. So this is a constant pressure action. Separation is a constant pressure action. So you first do a constant pressure separation, okay, so that this 0.2 comes closer to this vapor dome, okay, and then you throttle it, okay. So 1 to 2, you move along the constant pressure line closer to the vapor dome. That is the separation process. So 1 to 2 is which process? 1 to 2 is a separation process. And why you are doing a separation process? Because you want to come closer to the vapor dome. You want to come closer to the saturation curve. Okay. And once you come closer to the saturation curve, then you start throttling. So this way, by coming closer to the saturation curve, and after that, if you throttle it, we can ensure that after throttling, the steam becomes superheated. Okay. So this is how a separating and throttling calorimeter works. So in a separating and throttling calorimeter, you first separate the moisture, right, MW. So that X1 would be MW upon MS dot plus MW. Now MS dot and MS is same actually, right? That would be MS. So this you can measure it, means you need to measure the volume, specific volume. This way you get X1. And X2, how will you find? X2 you'll have to find as HF2 plus X2 HFG2 is equal to H superheated at 3. Okay, so why I equated 2 and 3? That is because the process 2 to 3 is isenthalpic process. Okay, throttling process is the isenthalpic process. Okay, so I use this equation. How to find HF2? Because you know pressure P2, that is this pressure, you know. Okay, HFG2 from the steam table, because you know the pressure. How to find H superheated 3? Because you know pressure P3 and temperature T3. Okay, so by knowing the pressure P3 and temperature T3, one can find H superheated from the superheated steam tables. Okay, by knowing the pressure before throttling, you can find HF2 and HFG2. So you'll get X2. You'll get X2. And then you can show it. This is left as a homework, that you can show that X is equal to X1 into X2. Okay. So the calculation part in the separating and throttling calorimeter is you find X1 by the relation MW upon MS plus MW. And you find X2 as HF2 plus X2 HFG2 is equal to S superheated. Right. So this, for calculating X1, you'll have to take the readings of volume and specific volume from the steam table. This volume reading you'll have to take from a calibrated beaker. This reading you'll have to take from the calibrated beaker. And then this you can read from the steam table, the specific volume of water at this temperature, right? And this way you can calculate MW and MS. Okay. So this MS and MW, once you get, you'll get X1, right? In order to find X2, what you'll have to do? You'll have to take the enthalpy before throttling. How to find enthalpy before throttling? Enthalpy before throttling is the enthalpy of the wet steam. How to find enthalpy of the wet steam? To find the enthalpy of the wet steam, you need to take either the pressure reading or temperature reading. And from the steam table, find the enthalpy values HF2 and HFG2. Okay, so suppose I know the pressure of the saturation steam, then I can read from the steam table the HF2 value and HFG2 value. The unknown would be X2. Then by knowing the pressure and temperature from this after throttling by using a pressure gauge and a thermocouple, okay, you can read from the steam table, superheated steam table, the value of H superheated. Okay, so in this equation now you have got H superheated by knowing the pressure and temperature, and you have got HF2 and HFG2 by knowing the pressure before throttling, right? This equation would yield you X2. Once you get X2, then by this equation, X is equal to X1 into X2, one can find the dryness fraction of the steam. Is this clear? If it is clear, say yes. If it is not clear, say no. Is this understood? Okay, Sushant has understood this. Jay has understood. Darshan has understood. Gargi has understood. Tejas has understood. Tejas Katokar. Anybody who has not understood this? Okay, Yash has understood. Yash More. Okay. So my request is again, yeah, thank you. My request is you please visit the videos also, so that especially the students who are finding it a bit difficult. Okay, they should use both the strategies. You should view the videos as well as you should refer to the literature, the books, I mean to say. To revise this. Okay, now with this I would say that the separating and throttling portion is over. This, once you come physically to the college, hopefully if you come, we would be performing a trial on separating and throttling calorimeter, right? Now I would move to the new topic, that is vapor power cycles. Okay, for this we would be conducting few more classes along with the diploma students. So those who are finding it difficult, okay, those who feel that they need more revision on this topics, they can join the classes which I would be conducting for the directly admitted students. Okay, you know that directly admitted students have not yet arrived, but within few days they would be joining the classes. So we would be conducting the entire session, not in that detail, but we would be in a fast track mode, we will be covering the syllabus for them. Okay, so those who find it difficult, okay, to absorb this material which I am being teaching and my colleagues have been teaching to you, okay, they should they can join those lectures also if they want. Okay, it is optional for them, right? So we will also solve practice numericals on this team later. Okay, for the time being, now I would close the chapter on properties of steam. Okay, and I would go to the new topic, the final topic, that is vapor power cycles. Okay, so let me ask you, Pranav, they have not yet been admitted, Pranav. So their admission is pending. Once the admission is done, Pranav, then their groups would be formed. Okay, so don't worry about that. I'll convey to you that when they are admitted. They are not yet admitted, Pranav. Right. So let me and if you have some doubt regarding some topics, okay, and you want a revision of that, you can also let me know later. Okay, now I am moving to the vapor power cycles. Okay, that is a new topic, final topic, and this assumes, this vapor power cycles topic assumes that you are comfortable with properties of steam. Okay, so while solving numericals on vapor power cycles, you would also be getting a feel of how to use the steam tables. Okay, so don't worry about that. So vapor power cycles, let me show you, let me write down what is that vapor power cycles. So vapor power cycles means, we are talking about a specific vapor, that water vapor I am talking about. So steam power cycles, basically steam power cycle is nothing but the thermodynamic cycle. It is a thermodynamic cycle which helps you analyze the thermal power plants. Okay, thermodynamic cycle which is relevant for analyzing the thermal power plants. So thermal power plant, you must be having some idea about thermal power plant. So whether anybody can list me the components of a coal based thermal power plant? Components of coal based, you can list down that coal based thermal power plant. You can just type the components. Components of coal based thermal power plants, what are they? Okay, preheater, economizer, furnace. I want the basic four components of thermal power plant. Basic four components of thermal. I am not talking about components of boiler, Pranav. I am talking about, I am not talking about the components of boiler. Okay, Tejas has written it correctly. One component is missing, Tejas. Four basic components. Electric generator is there, but that is not in the water cycle. The water cycle, when you are talking about, there are number of cycles in thermal power plant, but the working fluid cycle, the working fluid of the thermal power plant is water and steam. So the four components are boiler, that is the steam generator, then it is the steam turbine, then it is a condenser, and then it is a pump. Okay, so these are the four components. Four components are steam generator or boiler, then steam turbine, then a condenser, and pump. Okay, a pump. So let me just draw a block diagram of this components, block diagram. Okay, so there is a boiler, steam is generated. The steam goes to the steam turbine. In the steam turbine, the steam is expanded and then it goes to the condenser. and this condensate is pumped back to the boiler. This condensate is pumped back to the boiler. Okay. This is high pressure steam. This is low pressure steam. This is low pressure water. And this is high pressure water, pressurized water. Okay. These are the four components of a thermal power plant, right? These are the four components of thermal power plant. So let me ask you whether this is a heat engine, whether this is a heat engine, yes or no? Yes or no? Whether this is a heat engine, yes or no? Ganesh is saying yes. Whether this is a heat engine? Pranav is saying no. 50-50%. I want to decide this, and we'll decide it on a majority basis. Sushant is saying no. So now the majority is no, and the minority is okay. Jay is also saying no. So now the majority is 1:3. Okay, three students saying no, one is saying yes. Okay, now no. Atharva is saying yes. So Ganesh and Atharva are saying yes, whereas lot many students, Pranav, Sushant, Jay, Akanksha and Vedant Bokre, they are saying no. Okay, Sarika is saying yes. So Sarika, Ganesh and Atharva are right. Okay, they are right. So it is a heat engine. Why it is heat engine? Let me explain you. This device, there is a power plant. What it does, okay, look at this. I have drawn a boundary over here, control volume, and look at the energy interactions across the control volume. In the boiler, you are supplying the heat. In the steam turbine, you are getting work. In the condenser, the heat is rejected. In the pump, you need to supply certain work. Okay, so this, if you look at this now from the block diagram perspective, if you draw a block diagram for this, this is a power plant. Okay, so heat is being supplied to the boiler. From certain source, heat is being rejected via the condenser to the sink, and you are getting a net work output, which is this. Okay, so this is the block diagram for a heat engine. So this power plant is a heat engine which converts the heat to work. Okay, right? Now let me ask you this question. Theoretically, can we have the efficiency of this power plant as 100%? Yes or no? Theoretically, can we have the efficiency of a power plant as 100%? Yes or no? Theoretically, can we have the efficiency as 100%? Yes or no? Okay, Ganesh is saying no. Gargo is saying theoretically yes. Sarika is saying yes. Tejas is saying yes. Atharva is saying yes. Anantha is saying yes. Unfortunately, the answer is no. Okay, the answer is no. And why is that no? The reason is the second law of thermodynamics. So what the second law of thermodynamics says is that The second law of thermodynamics tells you that no engine, no heat engine can have an efficiency, whatever you do. No engine can have an efficiency equal to 100%. So that is not possible. Even theoretically, an engine cannot have an efficiency equal to 100%. Okay. So a power plant cannot have an efficiency equal to 100%. Even theoretically, please note that is what the second law says. Right. Now, what is the theoretically possible efficiency? So theoretically possible efficiency means theoretically possible maximum efficiency would be the Carnot efficiency, okay? So theoretically possible maximum efficiency would be the Carnot efficiency. Okay, Carnot efficiency. Now what are the processes of Carnot cycle? Tell me the processes of Carnot cycle. If you design a power plant on a Carnot cycle, it would have a maximum efficiency, right? So what are the processes of Carnot cycle? Anybody of amongst you? What are the processes of Carnot cycle? Anamta, Jay, Gargi, Sharvari, Aditya, Arawat. Okay, nobody remembers? Anybody who remembers the processes of Carnot cycle? See, the efficiency of the power plant would be maximum if you can design a power plant based on a Carnot cycle. So anybody knows what are the processes of Carnot cycle? Okay, Anamta has written isothermal expansion, adiabatic expansion, isothermal compression, adiabatic compression. Okay. So there are two reversible adiabatics and two reversible Carnot cycle means there are two reversible adiabatics and two reversible isotherms. Two reversible isotherms and two reversible adiabatics. Meaning what? Meaning during two processes, the temperature should remain constant, and during the other two processes, the entropy should remain constant. If you can design a power plant based on that, so let me try to draw this power plant on a vapor power cycle. Okay. I am drawing this power plant cycle, a Carnot vapor power cycle, on a temperature entropy diagram. Okay. What I am doing is, I am drawing a Carnot vapor cycle on a temperature entropy diagram. So this is a vapor dome. Okay. And this is the temperature entropy diagram. Okay. Vapor dome, this is a critical point. This is a saturation curve. This is a saturated liquid line. The area under this vapor dome is a wet steam. The area outside this would be superheated steam, right? And on this side, it would be a subcooled liquid. Okay. So I want to draw a Carnot vapor cycle, right? So let me draw the Carnot vapor cycle like this. Suppose this is your one, this is your two. This is 3, and let's say this is 4. Okay, so tell me, what is the state of the steam here? Tell me, what is the state of the steam at 2? State of the steam at 2 is a superheated steam. So what is the process 2 to 3? Tell me, what is the process 2 to 3? The process 2 to 3, anybody from you? What is the process 2 to 3? Process 2 to 3 would be a, which property remains constant during 2 to 3? Look at the diagram and tell me. Process 2 to 3, look at the diagram and tell me. No, Gargi. Process 2 to 3, it is the isentropic expansion. The entropy, look at this, this is a vertical on a temperature entropy diagram. So this is isentropic expansion. No, Pranav, it is wrong. 2 to 3 is an isentropic expansion. Okay. What is 1 to 2? What is 1 to 2? Sahil is correct. What is 1 to 2? Look at the temperature. Isothermal heat addition. What is 3 to 4? What is 3 to 4? Is isothermal heat rejection. The temperature remains constant while the heat is being rejected. Okay. And what is 4 to 1? 4 to 1 is isentropic compression. Okay. This is one type of Carnot vapor cycle. Okay, let me draw another type of Carnot vapor cycle. This is another Carnot cycle. Now, what is the difference between 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4 dash, and 1, 2, 3, 4? Whether 1, 2, 3, 4 and 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4 dash is also a Carnot cycle. Whether 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4 dash is a Carnot cycle? Yes or no? 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4 dash is a Carnot cycle? Yes or no? Sahil is saying it is reversible. 1, 2, 3, 4 is reversible. What about 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4 dash, then Sahil, it is irreversible? Gargi is saying it is not a Carnot cycle. See, it is a Carnot cycle. Both the cycles are Carnot cycles. Okay. Both the cycles are Carnot cycles. However, now the problem is, if you can design an engine, or if you can design a power plant, okay, if you can design a coal-based power plant, for example, on this cycle or this cycle, it would have the maximum efficiency. It would have the maximum efficiency. Maximum efficiency. However, the problem is we cannot design a power plant using the cycle 1, 2, 3, 4 or 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4. That means practically speaking, we cannot construct. Practically, it is not possible to design a power plant to operate on 1, 2, 3, 4 or even 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, 4 dash. Why is that so? Means, why one cannot design a Carnot vapor cycle, or why we cannot design a plant to operate on a Carnot vapor cycle. I mean to say that I am now trying to discuss the limitations of Carnot vapor cycle. Okay. Practical limitations of Carnot vapor cycle. If you can design it, then it would have the maximum efficiency as per the Carnot theorem. However, one cannot design the power plant based on the Carnot efficiency, Carnot power cycle. That is because if you look at the process 1 to 2, if I want to make this process 1 to 2 isothermal heat addition, then this 1 to 2, if I want to make an isothermal process, then this pressure, the pressure between 1 and 1 dash has to be continuously varied. This pressure has to be changed infinite number of times between 1 and 1 dash. Similarly, if you look at the constant pressure lines, okay, on a temperature entropy diagram, if you had seen the videos carefully, then Professor Murukar had shown you the constant pressure lines. These are the constant pressure lines. This is the temperature entropy diagram. Okay. So if I want to achieve this expansion, okay, if I want to achieve this, heat addition from 1 to 1 dash, 1 to 1 dash, you'll have this pressure is different, this pressure is different, this pressure is different, this pressure is different. It means that you need to design a boiler. You need to design a boiler whose pressure is changing continuously. Okay. Continuous change in the pressure. So continue designing a boiler. Nobody has yet designed a boiler whose pressure is continuously changing. What is available in the market is a boiler which is rated at a given pressure. Okay, so it is rated. So the process in the boiler is always a constant pressure process. It is not a varying pressure process. So if we are able to design a boiler whose pressure is continuously changing such that one can achieve a isothermal heat addition in the boiler, then and then the Carnot cycle would be feasible. Okay. Till then, we need to be satisfied with a boiler whose operation is at a constant pressure. So in other words, I need to change the process of the Carnot cycle. Your 1 to 2 process of a Carnot cycle was what? It was the isothermal heat addition. It was the isothermal heat addition. This was a process in a Carnot cycle. I need to change this process to a different process. Now, a different process would be a constant pressure heat addition. Okay. And when I'm changing this process 1 to 2, which is isothermal heat addition, to a different process, which is a constant pressure heat addition, that cycle would no longer be a Carnot cycle. It would be a something cycle. That something cycle, ultimately, I will be telling you, is called as a Rankine cycle. Okay, are you getting this point? Have you understood the process 1 to 2? Have you understood the process, the discussion around the process 1 to 2? Yes or no? Please tell me yes. If you understood this, say yes. If you haven't, just say no in the questions column. Have you understood this? Okay. Pranav is saying yes. Sarika has understood. Tejas has understood. So note that the efficiency of the Carnot heat engine will be the maximum. Efficiency of the Carnot heat engine will be the maximum. However, we cannot design a boiler which can give you the same process. Which process in the boiler? I mean to say, we cannot design a boiler which can have an isothermal heat addition. Okay. That is the reason why we need to change that cycle from a Carnot cycle to some other cycle. Okay. So I have not now changed. I have now modified the Carnot cycle to a new cycle where I have modified the process 1 to 2. Okay. Now let me go back to the another drawback of the Carnot cycle. Drawback, I mean to say, when I'm saying drawback, I'm not talking about a theoretical drawback. I'm talking about problem in designing a plant based on the Carnot cycle. Okay. it does not mean that the Carnot cycle would have an efficiency lower than the new cycle which I am talking about. Carnot vapor cycle would always have the maximum efficiency. Okay, please note this, right? Now if you take for example, this was the limitation, right? Now if I modify this 1:2 and if I want to make it isothermal, okay, if I want to make it isothermal, right, then one can think of this cycle. Look at this cycle, new cycle, Carnot cycle, 1-2, this process, whether 1-2 is an isothermal process, yes or no? Tell me whether 1-2 is isothermal or no. 1-2, 3-4 is also Carnot cycle. Tell me whether 1-2 is a isothermal process. Yes or no? Tell me yes or no. Whether 1-2 is isothermal. Tejas is saying it is isothermal. Ananda is saying it's isothermal. Okay. So the problem which we had, that we cannot design a boiler. Okay. Boiler with isothermal process has been solved in the cycle 1-2-3-4. Okay. Neha, yes, right? So now problem is, we have sorted out one problem, that, but we have another problem now at hand. What is that problem? If you look at this cycle now, if 1-2-3-4 is the Carnot cycle, and on this cycle, if I design a power plant, my problem one was solved. Which problem was solved? That isothermal heat addition is now possible. However, we have now two associated problems. What are those? One is, you get a steam which is weight at the end of expansion, and then handling this weight steam in the steam turbine becomes a problem. Handling this weight steam, because look at this, this is a weight steam, no, at 3-. So handling this weight steam, it becomes a problem in the steam turbine. Okay, so you sorted out one problem in the boiler, but now you are ending with the problem in the steam turbine design. The second thing is that if you are designing a boiler with this thing, then you don't generate superheated steam, and this will be stunning, that if the steam is superheated, the efficiency is better. Okay, and many other problems were solved out. So with the new design, 1-2-3-4, the steam would not be superheated, number one, because if you go and superheat it, then it becomes again a problem of achieving isothermal process, right? So you need to end that heat addition process within the vapor dome. Okay, so your heat addition would be at a lower temperature, the efficiency would be then lower. The second thing is, you end up with the wet steam, right? And that is again not a desirable option. So this cycle is ruled out. This cycle is ruled out, right? One more thing is regarding this 4:1. Okay. So now I'm talking about a new cycle. Yeah. 2:3. What is 2:3 in a Carnot cycle? It is a reversible adiabatic expansion. Okay, so this reversible adiabatic expansion is also possible in the new cycle. So I'm not changing this process. This remains the same. Reversible adiabatic expansion. Okay. 3:4 was isothermal heat rejection. Again, I am changing for the same reason. I am changing this to constant pressure heat rejection. Why is that so? Again, as I said, if you want to design a condenser, okay, such that it is outside the vapor dome. Okay, look at the diagram again here. If you want to design this process 3 and 3-, this 3 and 3-, here the condenser has to be designed such that the pressure is continuously changing. So if you change that pressure continuously, then and then you'll get isothermal. So the best way is that instead of achieving a constant temperature heat rejection, you go for a constant pressure heat rejection. You go for a constant pressure heat rejection. Okay, so you modify that cycle now. So what you have is a constant pressure heat rejection. Okay, so 3 to 4 now is constant pressure heat rejection, and 4 to 1, which was reversible adiabatic compression. Okay, this remains the same. This remains the same. So now you have a new cycle, and because obviously I have changed the two processes, which two processes I have changed? I have changed isothermal heat addition to a constant pressure heat addition, and isothermal heat rejection to a constant pressure heat rejection. So I cannot call this cycle as a Carnot cycle. The efficiency of this cycle would be less than the Carnot cycle. However, this cycle can be constructed. Okay, you can design a power plant, you can design a boiler which can give you heat addition at constant pressure, which you can design a condenser which can give you heat rejection at a constant pressure. And hence the power plant which we are talking about and which you see in the actual setups in the real life, that is not working on a Carnot cycle. It works on what is called as a Rankine cycle. Is this understood? So what are the processes in Rankine cycle? So processes in Rankine cycle is the heat addition is at constant pressure. The heat addition is at constant pressure, followed by an isentropic expansion in the steam turbine. Expansion in the steam turbine, and then a constant pressure heat rejection. And finally, an isentropic compression. Is this understood? So this now is a new cycle, which is the practical cycle, okay, on which the power plants are designed. And this is called as a Rankine cycle. So we'll continue with this discussion. I hope that this is understood. If you understood, say yes. Okay, so Jay Pranav has understood, Sharbari has understood, Saurabh Zadho has understood, Sarika Prajapati has understood, Rushali, Akanksha, Aramta, Sushant. Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot for being online. Okay, we'll continue with this discussion in the next class. Please start using the steam tables so that you get a practice of it. Okay, and we would be solving numericals on the vapor power cycles. That would be really a fun. Okay, have a good day.